We would like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land in which we gather today, and we pay our respects to their leaders, past, present, and emerging. In Aboriginal culture, it's customary to be introduced with an acknowledgement. Back in the day, our old people would have done this when introducing new people onto their lands. Its purpose was to voice the concerns for the visiting people, which back then was just usually the high maintenance of waterholes, sacred sites, and appropriate behaviour. This system of being welcomed has been a successful social tool for over 80,000 years, and it has become a modern Australian tradition. We see it in the formal settings such as Parliament, all the way down to our weekend football games. Like most ancient traditions, however, what the modern adaptation has failed to embody is the element of commitment. Fundamentally, the acknowledgement of country is an oath. I acknowledge the past, present, and future. That's a pledge of responsibility that we all Australians have to understand our culture in its entirety, conserve what remains, but to become people that will lead our culture into the future.
When you acknowledge the past, how far back do you go? The truth is, that this is probably different for everybody. For me, I think of a time before colonisation. Our people living free with the land, the way that they were supposed to be. For others, they may think of the trauma that their old people experienced. And for some, it could be an empty void, a feeling of longing, of thoughts that cannot fully form due to the dispossession of their history. Yet, there is a commonality throughout all these thoughts is a feeling, a sense of divine energy, the essence of our culture. Something that cannot be properly explained, but lives and resonates inside all Indigenous peoples. Something that can be only put simply as connection. And this connection is no better exemplified than when looking at our grandparents' recent history. And when I say grandparents, I refer to all of our old people from generations gone. Now, they were born on their country, but they were born into a life that would no longer exist. By their adolescence, brutal governmental control was enforced on all aspects of their lives. Some lost their language, some lost their practices, but for most, they lived a life that did not resemble the life they were supposed to live. So with that oppression and assimilation, how did they enable us to be here today?
The answer is that connection. The very same connection inside of me, my brother, and every other Aboriginal person. So a lot of people did lose their cultural practices and languages, but what the governmental regimes failed to recognise is how it's that connection that's the essence of our culture. How that connection directly informs our values of community, kinship, and respect. So even with all the tyrannical efforts of the government, our old people could still live lives worth living. That we can be here today pursuing our goals and dreams, because being Aboriginal is so much more than the practices themselves. Being Aboriginal is a way of being in the world, embodying those values of community, kinship, and respect.
So as our old people prevailed through the trauma, what became evident was that the essence of our culture wasn't defined by the visual or the celebratory aspects alone. While there was intention to dismantle our identity through the dispossession of language and practices, our culture was able to live on because it is so much more than those aspects alone. Similarly to how Christianity is so much more than the Bible alone.
The second aspect of the acknowledgement of country recognises the present. Even in my short lifetime, this country has seen such profound growth. We are afforded opportunities that even the generation behind us never were. But what we have experienced as the youngest people is the necessity to walk between two worlds. A constant tug of war between conflicting expectations and a false idea of Aboriginality And it's this false idea of Aboriginality that's pulling on the rope the hardest. And it's having tragic consequences for us First Nations mob and non-Indigenous people.
This quote was taken from a paper by Brian McCoy, and it summarises wider society's expectations of Aboriginality. He states that our culture is seen to only hold integrity when living in some ancient and idealised past. Our existence alone isn't enough to warrant integrity. Now, I think this is why Australian society has so openly embraced our dance and our painting. They are reminders of an ancient past. They allow for a disconnection. They can be returned to on convenient occasions, but can be so quickly forgotten about in everyday life. So this is where that divide becomes apparent, where we as young Indigenous Australians experience those two worlds. Our connection, our values for kinship, community, and respect are not appreciated in the same way because they don't meet those expectations. More importantly, they can't be turned off or just returned to when convenient. So we are forced to try and hold on to our identity in a society that doesn't accept its core.
Now, something that we both have been directly affected by is how higher educational institutions utilise a selection criteria under the guidance of Western values and Western standards. For example, with formal volunteering and extracurricular activities, with Indigenous positions and selected scholarships, it's so hard for young Indigenous people to meet them. See, we are so busy usually fulfilling our cultural obligations and community obligations that formal volunteering and extracurricular activities are often seen as time taken away from real contribution from community. And because we can't fulfil the criteria, we are denied the opportunities. We are denied the opportunity to progress our careers, yet we are the very people that the opportunities seek to uncover.
Now, if you go back and you think about our grandparents and what they endured, in particularly how they faced assimilation. This is a continuation of that assimilation ideology, however, conducted in more of a subconscious manner. While progress has been made to acknowledge our history, there still is a notion of Eurocentrism, that our culture must fit in and comply with modern Australian society.
Now, the final words of the acknowledgement of country are, I acknowledge the future and emerging leaders of tomorrow. But what is an emerging leader? I invite those in the audience here tonight and those watching at home, could you please close your eyes? I want you to picture Aboriginal disadvantage. What does Aboriginal disadvantage look like? Who does Aboriginal disadvantage look like? Now, I want you to picture Aboriginal success. Could you please open your eyes? Why were those individuals two completely different people? Why was their success removed from community?
Now, those differences that you've just envisioned may be confronting and it may come as a shock to you, but this is a trend that we are starting to observe, and it can be put down to that assimilation ideology, which has led to the celebration of superficial things without any substance. Now, we see multiple LinkedIn articles a week showcasing the positive progress that is made when an Indigenous person reaches a high position, whether that be in the corporate world, law, or even medicine. But on deeper analysis, it becomes apparent that these are Western success stories who happen to be Indigenous. It's not true Indigenous success. People are progressing, but communities aren't. You see, the reality for many of our young people is one of stress. The stress in having to carry the weight of expectations from both worlds. Add on top of that, a sense of fear and guilt that with every step we take in society, it could potentially mean creating distance from the very people that we live for. There are also Aboriginal people today without the first-hand experience of those realities. They've grown up in a Western system and understand Western success. The system has dominated and moulded their perception of Aboriginality. We can call it confirmation bias. They fit what the rest of society wants an Aboriginal person to be. They don't carry the baggage of those stresses that Australia deem as undesirable or too complex to work with. The system celebrates them when it looks good for the statistics, but it doesn't allow them to challenge the status quo. They become an individual success without the capability to advocate for or work with communities to ensure true Indigenous success.
So what's become important is that we need to think critically about the numbers that we accept. I want you to think back to the person of Aboriginal disadvantage. Are they the ones that are rewarded with the positive outcomes of improved statistics? And to the person of Aboriginal success, are they the people that are enduring the hardships that come with negative statistics? The numbers are important, but it's also so important that we think critically about them. It's so hard for quantitative data to comment on the quality of experience. One way we can do this would be to gain a deeper understanding of the numbers and differentiate the idea of Western success and how that idea can conflict with the Aboriginal way of life and Aboriginal success. So what should Aboriginal success look like?
Success looks the same as it has always been for our people in the past, where the whole of a community benefits, not just one person. When you close your eyes and you envision our success, you shouldn't see us away from our communities or looking any differently, but rather you should see us within our communities, working with our people, with skills obtained from a system that accepts and incorporates our ways and our values. So what needs to happen? As a society, we need to shift our perception of Aboriginality. We need to understand the significance of the First Nations person in the here and now. We need to understand that it is our connection, our value for community, kinship, and respect which hold integrity, not the superficial aspects put on full display or to confirm what the rest of society wants to see.
The most important question will always be, how do we do this? The acknowledgement of country is a perfect place to start. When you say, I acknowledge the past, the present, and the future, have a think about the intentions behind your words. Have a think about what you are committing to. But I think the most important thing that can be taken away from today is, how are you advancing your relationship with true Aboriginality?